He's a show business legend who has faced a life of poverty, controversy, jail time, and trailblazing success in the music world. He is the one and only James Brown. He burst onto the music scene in the 1950s with his unique sound and stage performance. He has not only become a music giant, but an inspiration to generations. But controversy has sometimes overshadowed Brown's success. No matter what tries to bring him down, he always makes it back to the top.
Oh, I feel good!
He's been called the hardest working man in show business, and for over 40 years, James Brown has inspired countless musicians, entertained millions of fans, and became the best-selling rhythm and blues artist in music history.
A lot of them came since him that were popular as well, like Jackie Wilson and, Sam Cooke and many others, but they came after James. James was in the beginning. So nice, 'cause I got
heat. Success is a byproduct, and luck is made by hard-working machines. And James Brown is a hard-working machine.
Get up, get on up, get up, get on up, stay on the scene, get on up like a sex machine.
James Brown's music and his style of rhythms has influenced every musician, contemporary today and yesterday. That's just a fact.
I work hard, I dance, I crawl across stage, and holler my lungs off everything I've ever had. And I thank God. In this country, I have some place to do it.
In the early 1930s, urban America was in the throes of the Depression, but the stock market crash didn't affect the daily lives of rural black sharecroppers whose existence remained mired in poverty. Susan Bellings had been working as a housekeeper in Barnwell, South Carolina, when she ran off to marry Joe Brown, a local turpentine worker. On May 3, 1933, in a one-room cabin in the woods of Barnwell, the couple's first and only child was born, James Brown.
They lived out in the country, and his father would work in turpentine camps. Sometimes he would work alone out in the woods. You'd tap the trees for turpentine, fill the barrels, and then get the barrels to the collection depot. And his mother cared for him there in the cabin.
Life was difficult in the Carolina countryside. Money was scarce, and the Browns survived on food gathered from the woods. By the time James was 4 years old, his mother became frustrated with the family's poverty and left her son and husband. In 1938, in search of better opportunities, Joe Brown took James across the Savannah River to settle in Augusta, Georgia, a rapidly developing manufacturing center. Faced with an erratic work schedule, Joe Brown left six-year-old James to live with his two aunts. Their house, located in the heart of Augusta's black neighborhood called The Terry, was a local haven for prostitution and gambling.
Aunt Handsome Washington was a very strong woman, even though she was running a brothel and selling illegal moonshine. She supported a lot of people, fed a lot of children. There were other children living in the house as well. And she always viewed James as being very, very special, and in fact told him at a very young age, she said, you know, someday the world is going to hear about you. And he would say, why do you say that? Just believe me, someday the world is going to hear about you. And he's always remembered that.
James began to show signs of musical ability early on as he blew tunes on his father's 10-cent harmonica. Joe Brown soon noticed his son's skill and surprised him with a gift that further triggered the boy's talent.
My father got an organ and a leg was off it. He bought it and I put a leg on it from a cheese crate, and he brought it to me about 11 o'clock that day. He got back by 7:30 that evening. I'd already learned how to play a song on it.
James ran home from school each day to practice the organ. He also learned to play the guitar with lessons from a well-known traveling bluesman.
Every now and then, the famous blues guitarist Tampa Red would come through and would sit in the front room there. And in fact, once, I believe, showed James an open tuning on the guitar called Sebastopol for musicians. So he did hear music there, and he did listen to the radio, and he listened to everything from country music to pop hits, and of course there was the music of the church.
A regular churchgoer, James's early musical influence came from hearing the gospel singing at Augustus Trinity Baptist Church. At home, he listened to early jazz and blues on the radio and soon began tapping out imitations of Count Basie and Duke Ellington on the organ. But when James came across the film shorts of jazz artist Louis Jordan, he then discovered his biggest inspiration.
I heard the Boogie Woogie, that flipped me over, so I got Louis Jordan. He was my mentor for what I'm doing today. He played alto, he sang Caledonia. What make your big head so hard, Caledonia?
James's practicing was quickly rewarded when the 11-year-old won first prize for singing at the Lenox Theater's Amateur Night. When James wasn't singing, he was boxing at the Bethlehem Community Center. In addition to these recreational activities, James earned extra money by setting up a shoeshine stand on the street corner of 9th and Gwinnett. Yet when shoeshining wages weren't enough, he turned to petty thievery.
Mostly what he did was break into unlocked cars, steal things like trifles like clothes and things like that, and mostly gave them away to his friends. It could hardly be called crime. Nevertheless, he was harshly punished for it.
When James was 15 years old, he was arrested for breaking into a car and sentenced to 6 to 18 years in the Toccoa, Georgia Juvenile Detention Center. James discovered two ways to cope with the hardships of prison life: sports and, of course, music. He organized a gospel trio complete with handmade instruments. The rest of James' time was devoted to swinging a bat for the prison baseball team. His two interests merged when he met another young musician, Bobby Bird, during a baseball game with a local community team. Although Bird wanted him to join his gospel group, James still had 5 years left to his sentence.
He wrote a letter to the parole board saying that he had done a lot with his music, with his gospel music, and while he was in there, and that he had hoped for a career in gospel music when he got out, and so on. And then one day, one of the fellow inmates came to him and said, "James, the warden wants to see you in a big way." And he went in there, and Mr. Matthews told him that his letter had won him early release.
On June 14, 1952, 19-year-old James Brown walked out of the Georgia Juvenile Training Institute a free man. He settled in the town of Toccoa, Georgia, moving in with Bobby Bird's family. Although he began singing gospel with Bobby's sister, Sarah, his attention quickly turned to rhythm and blues. James joined Bird's Toccoa band, and the group played their first professional performance together in a local juke joint called Bill's Rendezvous. When he wasn't playing with the Toccoa band, Brown continued to sing gospel at the Mount Zion Baptist Church, where he met a young parishioner named Velma Warren. The couple was married on June 19, 1953. Within a year, their first child, Teddy, was born. Sons Terry and Larry followed soon after. Although he now had a large family to contend with, Brown continued to focus on his band. With his unique vocal style and dance steps, Brown quickly moved to the role of lead singer. The Toccoa band then renamed themselves the Flames and began their journey to success. In the early 50s, American popular music underwent a series of changes. The big band era was coming to a close, paving the way for modern sounds of bebop, rhythm and blues, and rock and roll. This new musical climate was the perfect environment for James Brown and the Flames to flourish. They took their stage show out on the road, hitting every nightclub and honky-tonk on the Mid-South circuit.
When I was 12 or 14 in Greenville, South Carolina, James Brown was, of course, from Lower South Carolina and Augusta, Georgia. And it was a hotbed for entertainers and great athletes coming out of of Augusta, Georgia, Lucy Laney High School. And James Brown can be merged as the cream of that crop. When I was just in high school, he was singing Please, 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 and Prisoner of Love, and Try Me.
In 1956, King Records talent scout Ralph Bass heard a demo tape of the Flames and immediately flew to Georgia to sign the group to the King label. At the King studio in Cincinnati, the Flames recorded four singles. The first of these songs was Please, Please, Please. King president Sid Nathan disliked the song's repetitive chorus so much that he refused to release it. But Brown convinced Nathan to give the song a chance. When Please, Please, Please was finally released, it became an instant success. With the success of Please, 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 the famous Flames, as they were now called, were popular enough to be playing on the same bills with established artists, including Ray Charles and B.B. King. In 1957, singer Hank Ballard caught one of the famous Flames performances and brought them to Ben Bart, one of the industry's leading booking agents.
My dad went down, saw James Brown perform, thought there was a lot of potential. And he worked out a booking agency arrangement. He hired a publicist. He also did a lot of gimmicky type things. They were giving away at concerts automobiles and fur coats for the ladies. They used all these different gimmicks, you might say, to bring people in to see the type of show that he was doing so they could go back and tell their friends.
Unfortunately, the band's initial attempts to duplicate the success of Please, Please, Please failed. In order to bolster their image, Bart suggested the group change their name to James Brown and the Famous Flames. Well, this idea angered the other band members, who promptly quit, leaving Brown to carry on alone. He soon began experiencing problems with King Records. Sid Nathan was afraid of more commercial failures and turned down every song Brown submitted. So Brown put up his own money to record a new song, Try Me, and began passing the single out to local radio stations. When the record started to garner airplay, Nathan decided to release it, and James Brown had his first number one R&B hit. In 1959, Brown formed a new version of the Famous Flames and went back out on the road. One of his first stops was New York City's Apollo Theater, which marked the beginning of James Brown's long association with a legendary concert hall.
Well, the Apollo Theater was owned by a gentleman by the name of Frank Schiffman. You might say my father leaned on Frank to put James Brown into the theater, which he did, and he became one of the major players of the Apollo Theater, because when James Brown played the Apollo, lines would be around the block. And one winter they played, it was so cold that my father and Frank Schiffman were walking down the line handing out the hot coffee cups.
Brown's extensive touring schedule eventually caused his marriage to suffer. He became involved with his backup singers, and by the early 1960s, James and Velma were married in name only. Most of Brown's energy was spent perfecting his stage production. He gave 100% of himself when he performed and expected the same of his band. Brown soon became notorious for fining the musicians who didn't adhere to his strict guidelines.
James would be dancing and he would turn around and he would flash his hand at the band and, you know, on the beat, and it looked to be a part of the dance routine, but the story goes that he was levying fines for fluffed notes or that he would be dancing with his back to the audience and he would be shimmying past the band. He was checking their shoes to see if they were shined. And if they weren't, then that was $5 and so forth.
I remember I was in school in Lansing at the Michigan School for the Blind, and a great deal of the students one night went to his performance. And that was when I had a chance to talk to him at length, and he was just telling me about his band and what he demands of his band, and, you know, if their shoes weren't polished, they would get fined, and if they were late, they'd get fined. I like that concept.
His review featured numerous dances and stage antics, such as the cape routine inspired by wrestler Gorgeous George, and performed with the help of Danny Ray.
just got to happening over and over, but I always was there when the dressing room was in, because I knew he had to be wrapped up, and the crowd loved it each time he'd come back. Each time he'd come back and forth and kick it off and do his routine with that.
And I sung Please Please, and I dropped on my knees, and they put a towel on my back. And I ran off, and I kicked the towel off and came back. And I did it again, and did real well. It was highlights the whole thing. I admit that I probably did steal a show with a cape.
In 1961, James Brown's stage persona was broadcast into America's homes with his first television appearance on Dick Clark's American Bandstand. The next year, Brown's performance at the Apollo broke the theater's all-time attendance record. He documented these appearances with the album Live at the Apollo, which remained on the charts for an unprecedented 66 weeks. Since he was so well received in New York, Brown decided to move there, settling in the St. Albans section of Queens. In 1963, while still under contract with King, Brown defiantly signed with Smash Records and began recording new songs for the label. A lawsuit soon prohibited Brown from making any more singles for Smash. While the lawyers argued over recording rights, Brown spent most of 1964 touring the States. His appearance that year at the Tammy Show in California was a major concert event. This concert, known for showcasing the biggest names in rock and roll, featured Brown on the same bill with Marvin Gaye and the Rolling Stones. By 1965, Brown had bridged the gap from theater-sized venues to stadium concerts. He was eager to record again, so he resolved his problems with King Records and signed a new contract. As a peace offering, Brown gave Sid Nathan a copy of a song he had just written. This landmark composition featured a unique sound showcasing the new bag James Brown would use to revolutionize the face of popular music.
The real breakthrough record for James as far as funk goes is Papa's Got a Brand New Bag, and the title tells it. It's a new bag. It announces funk in an unmistakable way. It's, as in a great many innovations in black American music, the initial innovation is a rhythmic shift, and that's what funk is. And I think James Brown can legitimately lay claim to that.
In 1965, as the Beatles were dominating the pop world, James Brown was crowned the King of Rhythm and Blues. Riding this wave of success, he made his first movie appearance in Frankie Avalon's Ski Party, which introduced a new song that would become Brown's trademark anthem for decades to come.
Oh, I feel good!
Then I did I Feel Good and did the split. But you gotta tell you something too. It's a perfect cut the first time. I did the split. When I did the split, I split my pants. But I had a good act. I had to back out, and I backed out. That saved my integrity.
Brown exploited his film debut with appearances on popular television shows. His guest performances on The Lloyd Thaxton Show and The Ed Sullivan Show further fueled his fame. The Entertainer rang in 1966 with a sold-out performance at Madison Square Garden. In order to keep up with his busy touring schedule, he made a purchase that was a first for an African-American performer, his own Lear jet, complete with the titles of his hit songs painted along the side. 33-year-old Brown had now amassed over 30 charted records, a loyal following, and a career that seemed to have no boundaries. With Brown's success as a performer firmly established, he turned his focus towards social issues. He deeply regretted his own lack of formal education and decided to offer advice to young fans in the context of a new song, Don't Be a Dropout.
Don't Be a Dropout started off by saying a good friend of mine told me a story. I know he hadn't lied, so I went for a job, and just the man said without an education, he might as well be dead. I started with a seventh grade education, and I know that an education is so important.
The song coincided with Brown's Stay in School campaign aimed at black youth. He created a college scholarship program for promising students and introduced the campaign and record to Vice President Hubert Humphrey.
And you won't be able to do nothing unless you have a good education.
I've watched him attempt to be a part of the culture and also an unusual commitment to try to develop youth. Whenever he would go to a given city, he would not just hide in a hotel, but go to the prisons, and go to the communities. It is at that level that people begin to say, James is like, he's ours. So it's more than just the beat. It is the definite identifiable James Brown, funkin' now. Beat, but beyond the beat, there's a message and there's a messenger.
Don't Be a Dropout was just the beginning of Brown's new commitment to social issues that would soon become a staple in his life, both on and off the stage. As James Brown's career took a turn towards social awareness, he recognized that real empowerment for the black community would require more than slogans. He encouraged economic independence and used himself as an example by starting his own business empire. In 1968, Brown purchased three radio stations, and he also bought a chain of restaurants that became the Gold Platter, with a menu featuring his favorite variety of soul food.
Clearly, James, more than any other performer of his generation, really tried to seize control of his own career. He had various record labels at one time or another. In any negotiation, finally, any booker, any producer, any record executive was going to have to deal with James. He drove a very hard bargain.
Brown also became heavily involved with the civil rights movement. He gave a benefit concert to support James Meredith's March Against Fear and bought a lifetime membership in the NAACP. In April of 1968, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s assassination created a national panic. The threat of violent retaliation swept the nation. Brown offered support with televised concerts in racially torn Boston and Washington, D.C.
There were a few cultural figures who were dominant enough with their voices and had outreach enough to try to make some impact. I mean, people were going in their anger and frustration from reacting to genocide to suicide and self-destruction. And those who had voices to reach them, who had the courage to do so, did reach out. But James did not just say, please don't riot. He tried to turn some that pain into, as it were, Burn Baby Burn to Bill Baby Bill.
After the Washington, D.C. concert, Brown received a thank you call from Lady Bird Johnson and an invitation to a White House state dinner with the president. Later that year, Brown served the U.S. government once again. He made a journey to Saigon to perform for the troops, who gratefully received the entertainer.
It was important because no black performer go over and perform. I went to perform, but I didn't go perform for the blacks. I went to perform for the soldiers, period. And I went to perform for even a step beyond that, humanity, because I wanted to see us as a people be able to get along with people around the world.
Brown's political consciousness continued to grow with the release of one of his most influential records, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. This song assumed the status of an African-American anthem, and James Brown took his seat at the top of the charts again.
And always say it loud that you're proud.
Get what we deserve.
When he came out with the song Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, that was something that every black person related to. And I think that even those people that were not of African descent felt a sense of a pride, black, white, red, yellow, brown, because it was a song that says, yes, and you should be proud to be what you are.
We've always felt that because of being black, we was always put down because of it. But James Brown had the youth to know that it's okay to be who you are. A lot of the kids had been wearing hair one way, but when James Brown came out with I'm Black and I'm Proud, you start to see what we call naturals, and that meant showing black pride.
Although Brown's professional life was soaring, his personal life suffered some difficult blows. First came the death of one of his closest friends, manager Ben Bart. Then the IRS began an investigation relating to the numerous cash payments he received while on the road. In the midst of these crises, James Brown became the first African American to be voted Cashbox Magazine's Best Pop Male Vocalist of the Year. In 1969, Brown moved back home to Augusta, Georgia. He was now divorced and married to Dee Dee Jenkins, a Baltimore native Brown met on tour. James and Dee Dee were soon parents to two girls, Deanna and Yama. Yet Brown's demanding schedule left little time for his new family.
Well, wasn't home that much, but it's always hard to not be able to be home with your family, and for him to raise his kids, you know, and to always be there for the little things. So, but you gotta do what you gotta do.
As his career continued to move forward, so did Brown's notoriety. His face graced the covers of many national publications, including Look magazine, which took an especially profound stance on Brown's impact. In 1970, the core of Brown's band quit over a salary dispute before a show. At the last minute, Brown hired the Pacesetters, a local Cincinnati group that included bassist Bootsy Collins and his brother Catfish on guitar.
James said, well, I'm gonna call the songs off to you, and y'all just hit it, you know. And we got up on the stage, and that's what he did. But he kind of knew that we knew all the songs of his anyway. So all he did was get on the stage and call the songs off, and we kind of hit them. You know, and it was kind of like magic.
Brown's new band signaled a shift in emphasis from horns to guitars. This fresh sound led to a number of hit records, including Superbad and Get Up, I Feel Like Being a Sex Machine.
Sex Machine, that was probably one that we kind of had an idea before we got to the studio, because James rode the bus that night. And him and Bobby Bird were up there writing the lyrics on a paper bag, you know. And that was a deep night, because we finished the gig, and James wanted to ride the bus, and he got on the bus, and all of a sudden this vibe started happening, and he wanted to go to the studio. So we went straight from the gig to the studio and recorded Sex Machine.
Get up, get on up. Get up, get on up, stay on the scene. Get on up like a sex machine. Get on up, get up, get on up, stay on the scene. Get on up like a sex machine. Get on up, wait a minute, shake your arm, then use your ball. Stay on the scene like a sex machine. See the dance, you got to have a feeling. Shoot the bone, get it, come on, right on, right on.
In 1970, Brown attempted to duplicate his stateside success abroad by touring England, France, and Germany. He also staged a tour of the Ivory Coast, Zambia, and Zaire, later returning to Africa to perform at the Ali Foreman fight with B.B. King. As it turned out, Brown was extremely popular in Africa even before he arrived.
Oh my God, phenomenal.
These people went wild over James. He's a great dancer, he's got all that energy, he does it all. So they loved him, they were crazy about him. They was dancing with him. Me, I'm low key, so everybody, oh. But James Brown, everybody's with him.
Once again, Brown's professional triumphs were contrasted with personal torment. In 1973, his oldest son, Teddy, only 19 at the time, was killed in a tragic car accident. Although despondent over his loss, Brown kept making music. In 1974, Brown continued to expand his business empire by developing his own television series, Future Shock. But the 70s brought more strife as well. Brown continued his battle with the IRS, and the rising popularity of disco caused his record sales to decline. Having split from his second wife, Dee Dee, Brown decided to reappraise his life and shift his focus toward his children. Then, just when it seemed as though James Brown's career was at a standstill, a young comedy team asked him to appear in their upcoming film based on a Saturday Night Live sketch. Brown accepted the movie role, making a decision that returned him to the spotlight. James Brown stole the show with his portrayal of a preacher in the 1980 movie The Blues Brothers, which opened the door for a whole new audience to appreciate his rendition of the rhythm and blues gospel.
He was the perfect man to play the preacher because of just the energy level that he had in his normal straight act. You know, we figured he'd be the guy to pull off the gospel number for us. We picked a song called The Old Landmark, which is one of the fastest, you know, highest tempos gospel songs I've ever heard, and you know, of course, James was magnetic throughout. Landis and Belushi and myself wanted to go back and work with all these people who we loved in our youth. You know, Ray Charles, Aretha Franklin, John Lee Hooker, and of course, James Brown. What we were trying to do is, in the film, recognize these people as the artists who really were responsible for modern music.
In the early 80s, Brown continued to use both film and television to reinforce his status as the godfather of soul by making appearances on popular music variety shows, including Solid Gold and American Bandstand. It was during his 1982 Solid Gold appearance that Brown met a staff member who would become his third wife.
I was going through the rundown sheets, you know, the night before, and I said, "Oh, James Brown." He was very cordial to everyone, and he went down the line shaking everyone's hand, and then he said, "You're the one I want." And he planted a kiss right on me. And I guess that's kind of how we met.
Shortly after James and Adrian's wedding, Brown arranged to move both his mother and father to Augusta. It was the first time they were all together since Brown was 4 years old. Nearing his 50th birthday, James Brown had become a musical icon. He was publicly revered by his peers and had a new generation of artists paying him homage. At the helm of the hip-hop movement sat one of Brown's biggest fans, Africa Bambaataa.
You got a lot of hip-hop groups all based on James Brown and his brand of funk musically. And there's a lot, you know, you even had MC Hammer, who was doing a lot of the James Brown dancing mixed with his own dancing. The same with Prince. The same with Michael Jackson. And the same with a lot of people who's doing steps and moves out here, you know, with choreograph. They take little bits and pieces from the Godfather soul, James Brown.
With the dawn of rap came the era of sampling, a recording technique where parts of an existing record are mixed into a new song. Brown suddenly became featured in songs he hadn't recorded or even heard.
James Brown's got to be one of the most used samples of all time, so I think that people just see him as being timeless.
In 1986, the public was treated to another of Brown's breakthrough performances, this time in the movie Rocky IV. His appearance in the popular film helped launch the single Living in America and once again brought him to the forefront of the music industry. James Brown received a Grammy Award for Best R&B Male Vocal for Living in America. And that same year, he was inducted as a charter member into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Then, just when it seemed as though Brown was reaching new heights of success, his life took a turn for the worse. On September 24, 1988, he went on a rampage in his hometown of Augusta. He burst into an insurance office wielding a gun and then proceeded to lead local police on a two-state high-speed car chase. Brown's conviction for seven misdemeanor charges made news headlines around the country.
It was an apologetic James Brown who went before a Richmond County court today.
It was a very bad mistake on Mr. Brown's part that he's admitted many times.
Well, my experience was something I could never explain in my life. I made it shining shoes in Augusta, and there I was going to be killed by some stupid men. Even if I had been the most guiltiest man in the world, they knew who I was. They should have been smart enough to subdue me a different way and make it as quiet as they want to make it. Fair than what not.
Brown was handed down two concurrent six-year sentences. Although he had survived scrapes with the law before, Brown was no longer a teenager accused of petty thievery. He was now a grandfather faced with spending his golden years behind prison walls. However, not everyone agreed with the severity of Brown's sentence.
It seemed that the crime did not correspond with the time. And as we talked with various political leaders and the jailers, they would say, well, he's a model prisoner, and if this were someone else, he could get out, but because it is James Brown, because he is prominent, it would make headlines and it would expose us. And so, in a sense, he was a prisoner of the politics of the situation.
On February 27, 1991, after spending 2.5 years in prison, James Brown was released. The ultimate survivor, Brown used the notoriety of his incarceration to bolster his career. Instead of keeping a low profile, he staged a record-breaking pay-per-view concert.
His money prior to going to jail was around $30,000 a night. When he got out after 2.5 years of being incarcerated, his money went from $100,000 to $150,000 a night. Because he had gotten so much media exposure that people, they just wanted to see him.
When he went to prison and was gone away for 2 years or so, and he came back, I think it was the biggest comeback that I've ever seen. He was like rolling, I mean, just going.
I feel nice, I feel nice, a sugar refined. I feel nice, I feel nice, a sugar refined.
At age 61, after numerous jail terms and personal tragedies, James Brown once again managed to recapture his place at the top of his field. In 1992, with over 100 charted songs, James Brown was bestowed with the American Music Award's highest honor, the Lifetime Achievement Award. The next year, Steamboat Springs, Colorado dedicated the James Brown Soul Center of the Universe Bridge. In a similar tribute, a petition was circulated in Augusta to have a street named after the town's local celebrity. Brown continued his commitment to community action and philanthropic work. In the early 1990s, he designed the James Brown Stop the Violence campaign, which took him to local schools where he offered students encouragement and educational awareness.
He has withstood the test of time, and in so doing, he has not only built a cultural highway, as it were, that other people run down, he's helped people in the process. He's tried to reach beyond the stage. And so at the end of the day, you have to say James Brown has made a positive contribution.
Music remained foremost in Brown's life, and he continued his concert appearances both in the U.S. and abroad with packed shows from Atlantic City to Paris. He combined his musical expertise with his entrepreneurial instincts and began his own record label with a roster that included his daughter, Yama. In 1993, Brown suffered the death of his father. The funeral ceremony brought together several family members and close friends. This prompted Brown to form an even closer relationship with his wife and daughters. Brown ushered in his sixth decade with a new tradition, the annual birthday bash. Stars from all over the world flocked to Augusta, Georgia to celebrate with a performer who has become one of the industry's most respected and beloved elder statesmen.
I'm most proud of him that no matter what obstacles have come his way, he's always kept on going. I mean, he's been in the business for, you know, 40 years now, and it's just, he expands over so many generations, and to me, he's just kept on going no matter how the trends, you know, and times have changed. I respect him the most for that because he never let anything get him down.
He has that something that make the kids love him. Black kids, white kids, any kids. They talk about legends in their own time. If it ever was one, James Brown is.
James Brown made rhythm and blues music as significant in this country and throughout the world as the national anthem.
A friend of mine, his nephew, was watching a commercial, and his nephew's only 5 years old at the time. And so I think it was I Feel Good comes on in the commercial, and his little boy says, "Uncle, that's James Brown." And it was just amazing that a five-year-old child in this day and age would know James Brown. This new generation is aware, this new breed is aware of James Brown.
From the shacks of Barnwell, South Carolina, to the sold-out crowds of New York City's Apollo Theater, James Brown has shown the world his indomitable spirit, which earned him the title Godfather of Soul.
Oh, I feel good!
As the top-selling R&B artist of both the 60s and the 70s, Brown's inimitable style and signature sound changed the face of popular music and created an artistic standard that is unparalleled today.
Papa's got a brand new band. Hit that!
By reaching out to his audiences, Brown addressed social concerns and conveyed a message of empowerment. Despite his personal troubles, Brown managed to maintain a sense of dignity under the harsh glare of the public eye. For the hardest working man in show business, that may have been the most difficult job of all.
I feel good!
I will say one thing. When George Burns decided he wanted to take recess, then I worked 10 more years than I took, then I stopped.
He will dance until he can dance no more. I mean, dancing and singing and entertaining is his life. And he will never retire, and why should he retire?
James Brown will be remembered in history as the originator of funk, the originator of rap, the originator of hard R&B and hard soul. He would probably be up there among the top five performing artists of all time. I mean, he is a giant performer, giant talent, and perhaps one of the most entertaining and engaging, charismatic, magnetic personalities that God has ever created.
On January 6th, tragedy struck James Brown. His wife, Adrienne, died at the age of 47 after undergoing cosmetic surgery. The Browns were married for more than 10 years in an often stormy relationship.